Good midday. Miti means midday in my mother tongue, Garífuna.
Valdría la pena para que podamos conocer quiénes somos los Garífunas, de dónde venimos, y cómo es que
Who we are as a people, where we came from, the different roots that our peoples have taken within the Americas, including North America, but today we're specifically focusing on the Garífuna people. So we started there, and we've been in Central America since then, but at the beginning of 2016 we moved our Central America office from Managua, Nicaragua to El Progreso, Honduras, in the north of Honduras. And it was soon after that that the indigenous activist Berta Cáceres was killed in her home in La Esperanza. But we have had connections and have been working in Honduras since the 2009 military coup with civil society, who are in resistance against the repression and violence that has happened since the US-backed coup happened. My name is Alfredo López, and I'm the vice president of the Black Fraternal Organization of Honduras, OFRANEH, and by its Spanish acronym, which is coordinated by a very important woman there.
Esta mujer tiene un trabajo de más de 25 años con la compañera Berta Cáceres, por eso el asesinato de Berta Cáceres significó un golpe también para nosotros los garífunas.
Our president, Miriam Miranda, she has been working in struggle for 25 years, most of that time with the indigenous Monta leader, Berta Cáceres. And so that's why for us, as OFRANEH, the assassination of Berta Cáceres is something that is very significant and important to us.
Los garífunas en Honduras es una en los años 1600 los barcos negreros venían para América en una isla del Caribe, San Vincent, hubo una rebelión de estos barcos, de estos potenciales esclavos que venían para América.
So, talking about the Garífuna, so the origins are that in the 1600s, slave ships were bringing people from Africa to the Western Hemisphere, and they brought people. They were bringing people to the island of Saint Vincent, but then there was a slave revolt on some of those boats.
Estos esclavos huyeron a una isla cercana. Potenciales esclavos tenían para los mercados y escaparon a una isla. A esa pequeña isla llegaban los indios de que vivían en esta región, que eran los Calinas y los Arawakos.
So the people who were being brought from Africa to be slaves, who escaped that fate from those slave ships, escaped to an island, a small island in the Caribbean, where there were indigenous people who were the Arawaks and the Kalina indigenous people.
Y ahí se da una mezcla de estos negros que venían para América con esta población indígena, y por eso hoy en día está esta población de garífunas en Honduras, y que no llegamos a los mercados, sin embargo, hemos estado en guerra toda la vida.
So because for this reason you have this mix of people who were being brought to this slave market, but because of the revolt, didn't escape that fate, mixed with the indigenous Arawak and Kalina population. And that is the origin of why we are where we are in Honduras. It's also the reason, because our people began in this revolt, it's the reason why we sort of, as a people, have basically sort of been in conflict and almost at war, basically perpetually since that time.
Ustedes pueden ver en esta diapositiva los tambores, y los tambores son parte de nuestra vida. Es parte de este pueblo, a través de todos estos años, hemos podido preservar nuestra cultura, nuestras raíces, nuestras tradiciones y nuestra espiritualidad, que es, son elementos importantes para poder defender nuestros derechos, más ahora con el derecho internacional que nuestro país es, ha firmado convenios y tratados del sistema interamericano.
So here in the slide, you can see the drums that are a very important part of Garífuna life, part of our people's life. And this is a part of the culture, the roots, and the traditions, as well as the spirituality that we work hard to preserve. And we put a lot of time into defending these rights and traditions, including to the point of defending these rights before international bodies via the conventions and measures through which they are protected internationally and especially in terms of the Inter-American system.
Como pueblos culturalmente diferenciados, nos movilizamos la mayor parte del tiempo. Y siempre con nuestros tambores que hacemos bastante ruido, ¿verdad?
As what we call in Honduras culturally differentiated populations, we are mobilizing ourselves all the time. And that's what you can see here, and that's why we have to make a lot of noise with these drums, right?
Así es. Últimamente hay un elemento muy importante que son los narcotraficantes que se han metido a nuestros territorios. Y cuando los narcotraficantes disparan, nosotros disparamos nuestros tambores.
So, as of late, one of the dynamics that we find in the territories, our territories where we live, is the element of narco trafficking. And so when the narco traffickers come in and start shooting, we respond by shooting, quote unquote, by playing our drums.
Es una guerra de David contra Goliat. Sin embargo, todavía estamos vivos.
So it's a sort of David versus Goliath struggle that we are in, but we are still alive and still struggling.
De manera que como estamos asentados en la costa caribe hondureña, nuestro patrimonio es la pesca artesanal, ¿verdad? Nuestros ancestros eran muy buenos marineros. Y la agricultura de subsistencia. Por eso somos objeto de esta violencia, porque mucho de este tráfico de ilegal se hace vía marítima y se hace en las zonas retiradas de la población humana, y esas zonas están pobladas por población indígena. In Honduras.
We're the Garífuna people are mostly concentrated in the Caribbean coast, and so our major economic activities are artisanal fishing as well as subsistence agriculture. Our ancestors were were very good fishermen and boat people, fisher people and boat people, or sailors rather. Because of where we are in terms of being as indigenous peoples and Afro-Indigenous peoples, where we're concentrating, because of that, for that reason of where we're geographically concentrated, and especially in these maritime areas, that makes us objects of violence that's associated with this illegal trafficking activity.
Y tenemos un compromiso muy, muy especial sobre este tema, a pesar de los peligros. Sin embargo, como víctimas de este negocio sucio, nosotros fuimos encarcelados en mi país por 6 años y medio acusado de narcotraficante.
So we have given, in light of this situation, we have a special commitment to persevering in the face of this. We are victims of the violence that comes along with this like dirty business that the drug traffickers do, and sometimes we suffer consequences because of it. I myself was jailed for 6.5 years for a falsified charge of drug trafficking.
Como pueden ver, es una campaña permanente en contra de los líderes que estamos luchando. Y esta campaña se trataba de un megaproyecto turístico en nuestra comunidad que se llama Triunfo de la Cruz, que estaba pretendiendo montar un mega proyecto turístico de hoteles que se llama Marbella. Marbella es un complejo hotelero de Europa que llegó a nuestra comunidad para plantear un proyecto turístico de 17 millones de dólares.
So, as you can see, there is basically a permanent campaign against us, against the leaders in our communities, and part of this permanent campaign is a mega project that has been forces have sought to impose in the community where I'm from, which is called Triunfo de la Cruz. And what it is a big hotel complex that is from a European company, and the hotel is called Marbella. And it's a $17 million project.
Y este proyecto finalmente se paró porque estando yo en la cárcel, fueron con un cheque que yo tenía que poner las cifras para sobornarme. Y yo lo mandé al carajo y al final. Solo han quedado construidos como 9 casas que son parte de este caso Triunfo de la Cruz en contra del Estado de Honduras, que el año pasado la Corte Interamericana se pronunció a favor nuestro en 2 casos que ya voy a hablar sobre.
The project that they were going to impose was stopped through a process that happened through the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, and it is one of the 2 cases that I'm going to discuss.
A finales del año que pasó, a principios, tuvimos el fallo de la Corte Interamericana, 2 fallos en un año en la Corte sobre 2 casos de violación del derecho ancestral de estas dos comunidades garífunas. En total somos 46 comunidades, pero ahora mismo solo tenemos dos casos que se han dado la corte. ¿Qué pasará con las otras comunidades que están sufriendo igual asunto? Bueno, eso está por verse, porque estamos en las cortes en este momento.
At the last year, and especially toward the beginning of last year, we had two rulings in our favor within the American Court of Human Rights in terms of dealing with that our ancestral rights to territory had been violated. And there are 46 Garífuna communities in Honduras, but only two court rulings that happened that year. So what about the rest of the cases that have been brought within those 46 communities? We will see about that because some of those cases are still in court.
Triunfo de la Cruz es, como les decía, es mi comunidad y es una de las que está que vamos a revisar que se cumpla esa sentencia. El otro caso es la comunidad garífuna de Punta Piedra versus el Estado de Honduras. Este caso es similar. Las tierras de las comunidades garífunas no existe la propiedad privada, es colectiva, ¿verdad? Basado en los principios de la solidaridad, la hermandad y todo eso que tiene que ver con la unidad granítica, que tiene que ver con preservar el territorio colectivo, la colectividad. Por eso tenemos un título que es de todos los que vivimos en las comunidades. Y promovieron invasiones, personas que tienen muchos recursos, invasiones para que estos invasores le vendieran a los narcotraficantes las tierras. Y hemos, por eso fue que demandamos al Estado, y al final la Corte dice que el Estado estaba atentando en contra de la propiedad ancestral del pueblo garífuna. En el caso de Punta Piedra, donde hay minas, donde hay una serie de recursos que se quieren quedar con esos recursos, sin contar con la población. Y hay títulos de dominio pleno en nombre de las comunidades.
Okay, so in the case of Triunfo de la Cruz, that's my community, and it's one where we are monitoring and reviewing things to make sure that the Honduran state complies with that court ruling. And in the second case, which is the Punta Piedra versus Honduras, which is another Garífuna community, in this situation of Punta Piedra, its land is collectively held, so there's no private property, which is this sense of collective titling is based in senses of solidarity, brother and sisterhood, and the unity forged within a sense in which land is collective and the title belongs to everyone. And in this case of Punta Piedra, there were invasions, incursions into this territory by actors and people with a lot of resources. In order to basically make a land grab and sell that land to people who are narco traffickers. And so that is why we first brought this case to the Honduran state and ultimately to brought it to the Honduran state through the Inter-American system and the Inter-American court. And it's the talking about the area where it is prescient because there are a lot of like areas that where there are mines present and other natural resources in that area that they wanted to take control of, that these interests wanted to take control of without our assent to that, free prior and informed consent to this, to which we are due.
Por eso estamos permanentemente, les decía, tenemos que presionar en la capital, ¿verdad? Para poder promover nuestros reclamos. Desde luego, hay una campaña mediática porque ellos manejan los medios corporativos, los medios de comunicación y los periódicos, ¿verdad? Donde se minimiza todo este trabajo. En esta diapositiva podemos ver aviones que se utilizan para las actividades del narcotráfico en Honduras. Pero el problema aquí es muy grave porque son las mismas autoridades y los militares encargados de este negocio. Y son los mismos que están apoyados por los políticos de acá, quienes están luchando fuertemente en una guerra contra las drogas.
So it's for reasons like this that we are permanent of our land and of our resources, but there is a very fierce and concentrated media campaign against us because the people who want to take advantage of our territory and dispossess us from it are those people with resources are also the ones who are in charge and own the media, all the different means of communication in the country. And as you can see here on this slide, you can see the description of narco activity. But what's ironic here is that the same political leaders and captains of industry in Honduras, under whom we're suffering, are allied with these drug traffickers, and those the politicians in our country who have these alliances with drug traffickers are often helped and aided by politicians here in the United States.
¿Cómo funciona el asunto? Bueno, estos disque empresarios y con todos los recursos que tienen, de manera ilegal, compran las tierras colectivas de los pueblos y siembran palma africana. Cuando llenan las comunidades de palma africana, ya no son narcotraficantes, sino que son empresarios. Y exportan esta materia prima a Estados Unidos, donde se convierten en perfumes, en jabones, en un montón de productos, que usted, hasta cereales, ¿verdad?, que consume el pueblo norteamericano y los europeos, desde luego, ¿verdad? Entonces, es un cuento de nunca acabar. Mientras nos asesinan en nuestras comunidades, aquí los mercados están abiertos, los bancos están lavando la plata, y mientras tanto, algunos de nosotros sufrimos los asesinatos, las persecuciones y toda la campaña de desinformación, porque ellos mismos manejan los medios.
So how does this work? So business people, business owners, come in and illegally acquire and buy this collective land, which they can't do that legally. And on this land, they put in African palm plantations, palm oil plantations. And so through coming in and putting these plantations into place, they supposedly changed from being narco traffickers to being business people, legitimate business people. And the products from palm oil in Honduras reached the US in the form of different products such as perfumes. They're in a lot of food products, palm oil in a lot of food products here and in Europe. And so it's a story that never ends. So the markets are open for these products to enter here in the US. The banks launder the money on this end, and then on the other end, leaders in these communities and activists get killed, and there's also a disinformation campaign about what's really going on.
Podemos ver en esta diapositiva y un señor muy sonriente de abajo con los militares, ¿verdad? que en Honduras muchas de las ayudas que van del pueblo norteamericano que trabaja fuerte y algunos hermanos nuestros emigrantes que tienen hasta dos trabajos, que trabajan como burros para pagar sus impuestos, muchas de esas ayudas llegan a nuestro país y a otros países disfrazados de ayuda humanitaria y luego se convierten en armas, en asesores para enseñarle a disparar a los soldados y asesores paramilitares colombianos, porque tenemos el plan Colombia en Honduras, y asesores de judíos. Entonces, esto es la muerte para nosotros, prácticamente.
So, in this slide, you see this smiling gentleman over here, it speaks to the different kinds of money that's coming into Honduras, and one is remittances from Hondurans who are coming in and working multiple jobs, working ridiculous hours and so hard to pay their taxes and be able to send money to Honduras. And the other kind of money that's coming in is this quote unquote humanitarian aid, which is really aid to military aid disguised as humanitarian aid, and so it's coming in through military advisors that are from the US, or they're from Colombia, they're from Israel, who are teaching people how to repress and kill people. And also you have, within the Colombian advisors that are coming in, you have Colombian military advisors who are implicated in collusion with right-wing paramilitary groups in Colombia, and that's part of where you see the extension of the U.S.'s in Colombia, in Honduras, and in Central America.
Hay un señor que fue presidente de Colombia, Uribe. Yo creo que todo el mundo. Uribe es el asesor principal del gobierno hondureño. Y creo que él es el padrino de los hondureños ante el Departamento de Estado, ¿verdad? Y él tiene dos fábricas en Honduras para transformar los productos de aceite de palma africano. Durante el golpe estuvo ahí permanentemente viajando a Honduras y era recibido por la oligarquía hondureña como el rey. Eso es perfecto.
And so you have the one actor within this scheme of things is the former president of Colombia, Álvaro Uribe, who is basically is one of the principal advisors to the Honduran governments that came out of and after the military coup in 2009, and he is somebody also was very close to the United States and the State Department during his time. And he is somebody who has two factories in Honduras, who owns two factories in Honduras that process palm oil into process the palm fruit into different products. And he was somebody who was constantly during the coup d'etat, he was the sort of godfather of the coup d'etat, and he was constantly coming to Honduras and promoting the activities that the governments that came out of the coup were involved with.
Y para pasar a la siguiente diapositiva, vamos a esta investigación nuestra tiene aproximadamente más de 5 años. Esta presentación la vengo haciendo hace más o menos 3 años. Pero ahora que estoy acá, este año, el presidente Juan Orlando Hernández, el presidente actual de Honduras, ha extraditado unos capos para acá, para Estados Unidos, y están dando declaraciones, ¿verdad? Y están declarando están denunciando a este señor Pepe Lobo, el primer presidente después del golpe, y su hijo, que está preso por narcotraficante. Y están denunciando al señor Lobo como que le pagaban a él para que los dejara operar, asesinar gente. Y ellos mataron al zar de la droga allá en Honduras, y mataron a otro señor muy destacado en tratando de erradicar el negocio de las drogas, y encargados de los escuadrones de la muerte en Honduras. Eso es lo que se está hablando ahora mismo, aquí, en Estados Unidos. Pero toda esta gente está tranquila allá en Honduras, como que no pasa nada, ¿verdad? Y por eso para nosotros es importante hablar con la gente de Estados Unidos, que muchas veces no se da cuenta de estas cosas, porque pasan bien ocupados, la presión del sistema no los deja atender estas cosas que tienen que ver con sus vidas, porque se está tomando decisiones en nombre de la gente, ¿verdad? Entonces, y que están dañando a nuestros pueblos enteros, ¿verdad? Y el otro tema.
So this the research that we've had that's gone into discussing this we've had has been going on for 3 to 5 years, and one of the things that we've been following is that this year the current president of Honduras, Juan Orlando Hernández, extradited people to the U.S. On drug charges, and as part of this extradition process, these people had to make sort of declarations about what they had done, the crimes they had committed, and a lot of these declarations implicated the gentleman in the last slide, who was Porfirio Pepe Lobo Sosa, and his son. His son's in jail here on drug trafficking charges, and in these declarations that these drug traffickers made once extradited here, included talking about how they had killed people at the behest of political leaders like Pepe Lobo, including a distinguished person who was a distinguished gentleman who was working against drug trafficking, and they also declared in these statements that
that they operated in a death squad activity formations. But the issue is that a lot of these political leaders who are linked to this are just, you know, living in Honduras as if there's nothing wrong. But the issue is that a lot of this, that it's important to be here talking to folks in the US about this, because this information is sometimes hard to find. It's hard to find time to dig into these topics. And also it there are political interests that want to make it so that it's hard to uncover the truth.
También es relevante en estos momentos que estas declaraciones mencionan al presidente que está ahora mismo, ¿verdad? Eso es lo más triste, y que este tipo está pensando reelegirse después de 4 años de pesadillas para el pueblo hondureño.
And this is relevant because it's tragic that the current president Juan Orlando Hernández is implicated in a lot of these things, and right now he is trying to make it possible so that he can be reelected, which is something that is not allowed under the Honduran constitution. And this is after 4 years of what's been basically nightmares for much of the Honduran population under his presidency.
O sea que lo que tenemos ahora en juego es quién va a controlar el negocio. Realmente no es erradicar la corrupción ni las drogas ni nada de eso, sino que quién controla los carteles para manejar los recursos.
So what you have really in play right now is not how are we going to get rid of drug trafficking or really resolve this issue, but who's going to be who's in control of the business, of the activity, who is going to be pulling the strings that affect and control what these cartels are doing, and the resources that they are that they have captive.
Por eso nosotros estamos totalmente de acuerdo con estas palabras sabias del profesor Chomsky, ¿verdad? Que la guerra contra las drogas es un instrumento del gobierno norteamericano para criminalizar a los pobres.
And so, because of this, we are completely in agreement with the wise words of Professor Noam Chomsky, that you can see here, that the war on drugs is essentially an instrument by the U.S. government, of the U.S. government, to criminalize poor people, essentially.
Y eso es triste, ¿verdad? Porque nosotros entendemos que el pueblo norteamericano no tiene nada que ver con nuestras políticas, sin embargo, se hace en nombre del pueblo. Eso es una pena. ¿Y cuál es el resultado de estas políticas, no sé de dónde, cómo llamarlas, más emigración a través de esas fronteras, que dicen que van a construir muros, pero los muros no van a parar este asunto? Pueden construir un muro hasta el cielo, pero eso no va a parar la migración. Lo que va a parar la migración, que si se pudiera, que la mínima parte de estos recursos, que no lo gasten todos, no necesitamos que gasten todos esos recursos en educación, en salud para la gente, promover empleo, que en vez de tener ese montón de soldados que no sirven para nada, no, nosotros no estamos en guerra. Lo que necesitamos son asesores para sembrar comida, producir alimentos. No necesitamos armas, ¿para qué? Entonces, eso es lo que va a aminorar la emigración de los países nuestros como Honduras.
And so, and this is, it's a sad reality. What Professor Chomsky mentions here is because we understand that the people in the U.S. Are not the ones who are promoting these policies. They don't want this war on drugs that is so devastating. But it's painful that it continues to happen in the name of the U.S. people without being the actual desire of the U.S. people. So what are the effects of the drug war? So one you see is migration from the countries where the drug war is happening. And we hear a lot of talk about, especially now, about walls being built, a wall along the southern border. But the walls are not going to stop migration. You can build a wall to the sky, and it's not going to resolve the root causes. The only things that will diminish the flow of migration from the countries, from these countries, is putting resources towards education, health, food. We don't need weapons or military advisors. We need advisors to come and help us maximize our food production so that people are taken care of in that way.
Desde luego, tenemos que luchar para erradicar la corrupción, porque ese es el fondo de la cuestión, ¿verdad? Mientras tenemos una corrupción, entonces el presidente le están diciendo de aquí que tiene que armarse hasta los dientes, entonces todos los recursos van para armas. Le reducen el presupuesto de la educación para armas, reducen el presupuesto de salud para armas, entonces de repente vamos a comer armas.
And so what we have to do is work to stop the corruption that goes hand in hand with all of this that I just mentioned that's happening. We have so many resources that go to militarizing the country, to buying so many weapons, and instead of putting them towards education, health, so we've gotten to the point that we are buying so many weapons that we're gonna have to start eating weapons because there's nothing else that we're bringing into the country.
Finalmente, también perdemos el territorio y criminalización de los movimientos sociales. Por eso el asesinato de la hermana Berta Cáceres, y estamos luchando para que se pase esa ley acá en el Congreso. Venimos ahora de una reunión y vamos a seguir hoy, vamos a ir a la Comisión Interamericana. Aquí, como producto de esa guerra contra las drogas, una confusión en la Moquitia, la DEA ametralla una lancha de civiles, dos mujeres embarazadas asesinadas, confundido con lanchas de narcotraficantes. Y ametrallaron a esa gente y tenemos esos resultados. Esa gente son pobres.
And so the other effects of the drug war are, we have the loss of the territory that I've gotten into, some, as well as the killing of activists like Berta Cáceres, and with the Solomon mentioned the law, the Berta Cáceres Human Rights and Honduras Act, and so killings like her assassination are why we need that law. We actually just came from a meeting with a member of Congress, and then we're going to be going to the Inter-American Commission a little bit later on. One of the examples of this uh, of both the killings of people and criminalization of poor people and of communities and of activists is what happened in the area that's called the Mosquitia in 2012, where there was a counter-narcotics operation, supposedly, by the Honduran military, in which the USDEA, the Drug Enforcement Agency, had a direct role. We don't know exactly what that role is, but they definitely were involved. It's been hard to find out the exact nature of that role. And so what happened was there was a small boat on its daily commute to take its to carry out its activities, and four civilians, innocent civilians, were massacred in that, including two pregnant women, because apparently the Honduran military, with whatever advisory role or more direct role that the DEA was playing, mistook this little boat for the boat of drug traffickers.
Y finalmente, hay algunas recomendaciones que necesitamos si es posible el apoyo de la ley Berta Cáceres, que se viene trabajando desde el año pasado. Particularmente, nosotros estamos en una campaña desde la muerte. Hasta ahora solo tienen los peces chicos en la cárcel, pero los grandes no los tocan todavía.
So right here we have some recommendations of things that would be helpful with regard to the situations that I've been talking about. One is a very strong campaign that we have right now to get the approval of the Berta Cáceres Human Rights in Honduras Act, H.R. 1299, and we're in a campaign campaign unto death to have the resolution of the circumstances of Berta's murder. Right now, we've gotten a hold of the small fishes that are responsible, the people that probably pulled the trigger themselves, but the big fish, the people who planned it, the intellectual authors often refer to, they are still at large, and so we're continuing on to get closure for Berta's murder.
Y la militarización continúa. También hay un proyecto, el último, del presidente, nuestro presidente Obama, que es el Fondo para la Prosperidad, $1,000,000 para El Salvador, Guatemala y Honduras. La farsa más grande en que pudieron engañar a nuestro presidente. O sea, el Producto Interno Bruto del gobierno hondureño es mediante las remesas de la gente que está acá. ¿Cómo él va a estar interesado en regular esa gente que viene acá? Eso no es cierto.
And the militarization continues. One example of this is that you have started under former President Obama and continuing now, and actually just a side note, the current DHS Secretary John Kelly is a big fan of this plan, but you have what's called the Alliance for Prosperity in the Northern Triangle, and this is the biggest farce that you could imagine. Because this plan is supposedly in place to decrease migration from the countries in the Northern Triangle, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras. But the issue is that the GDP of these countries, including Honduras, is based in remittances that people working outside of these countries send back. So where is the genuine interest in stopping this?
Y lo que sabemos y entendemos que vamos a seguir comprando armas, llevando militares y pagando escuadrones de la muerte y paramilitares. Y por eso estamos en contra. Mientras no se resuelve el asunto de la corrupción, no debería de ir ni un dólar para estos países. Lo que necesitamos es iniciar un proceso de que funcione, aunque sea de manera incipiente, esa democracia que dicen que nosotros tenemos. Ninguna democracia puede sostenerse en el poder ejecutivo nada más. Tiene que estar el legislativo, el judicial y el ejecutivo, desde luego. Pero si el ejecutivo es el que toma todas las decisiones y despide a todo el que está en contra de él, eso no es democracia, puede ser cualquier cosa, pero no es democracia.
And also the other issue within the Alliance for Prosperity plan is that within it, there's a very high amount of funds designated for the state security forces of these places, including Honduras. So basically the trend is that via the Alliance for Prosperity, we're going to keep buying weapons, we're going to keep training soldiers, we're going to keep having military advisors come in to do this. But what we end up with is death squad activity, intense militarization, paramilitarization, and this can all happen thanks to corruption. And so what we say is that there shouldn't be $1 spent on the corrupt government of Honduras until it demonstrates some modicum of democracy. Right now, a democracy is not based just in the executive power. In Honduras, the executive power does everything and is in control of the other branches, but you know, to have a healthy functioning democracy, you have to have some sort of independent legislative and judicial branch, which we do not have in Honduras. When some entity within the government disagrees with the executive branch, they're basically kicked out, and that is not what happens in a real democracy.
Muchísimas gracias. Finalmente tenemos la última fotografía de nuestras líderes. Berta Cáceres, que ya no está, sin embargo, Miranda continúa trabajando con nosotros, pero ahora el pueblo garífuna ha tenido que plantear la seguridad personal para ella, porque la verdad es que no podemos continuar perdiendo a estas importantes mujeres que tienen que ver con la vida de nuestro pueblo. Tenemos 10 minutos para aclarar algunas, si hay algunas preguntas, y quiero pedirles disculpas porque nos extendimos un poquito más del tiempo, pero les agradecemos por estar aquí, y si en algo podemos ayudar para aclarar lo que no está claro, todavía estamos aquí por 10 o 15 minutos.
Okay, and so this brings us to the last slide, and that's to say thanks in Garífuna, Spanish, and English up there. And right here we have some leaders, important leaders from our communities. We have Berta Cáceres, who is no longer with us, but we also have Miriam Miranda, who's the president of OFRANEH, the Black Fraternal Organization of Honduras. And what we've had to do within the Garífuna community is make sure that her Miriam's personal security is looked after, because we can't keep losing these amazing leaders, especially these amazing women leaders who are so powerful. And right now we have about 10 or 15 minutes to have any questions, any clarifications that anyone might want to ask about or make. I'm sorry to have taken so much time, but if you have any questions, we can address those with the time that we have remaining. you so much.